You know, why don't we look at one of
these
layers?
Let's look at the bones.
Yeah, let's look at the bones themselves. And so then we went out to Wyoming. And this is actually the first place that we went together. That was our first trip. These were done out of order, but we went with Art Chadwick, who has been digging for 20 plus years there in Wyoming at this ranch owned by two sisters. Well, I asked them, I said, how did you know there were dinosaur bones here? And she said, well, you know, we knew they weren't cow bones. So he then was a Christian and opened this up to creationists to come and dig there. And Art's been digging there for 20 years every June. And other people can go, you can go through Art at his at Southwestern Adventist University. And so he really, I think, was opened my eyes originally to this size of this, basically, of the fossil record. And and I think that's the key deal. So the big point about Art, and it was sometimes hard to explain because sometimes scientists are very, they talk in technical language, but the very simple deal is you had a single layer that was 1 meter. Mm-hmm. So we're talking 3 feet. Yep. And it's a layer that went basically for about 100 acres, he thinks. Mm-hmm. Parts of it have been eroded away since then, but that 3 foot layer, if you just stretch it out at one time, it was a single layer, is filled with, you know, millions of dinosaur bones. You know, 5,000 to 10,000hadrosaurs and other dinosaurs that had been killed at one point. They floated and bloated, they got disarticulated and rotted, and then another mud flow came and put them together in that 3 foot layer. Yep. And we saw it with the big bones at the bottom and the little bones at the top, that hydro sorting, a catastrophic event. Right. And it's an incredible picture, and this is just a little bitty snapshot of what the flood did with the fossils. And I think that was really eye-opening with Art to see the data in the ground and how the data in many cases, yes, can be interpreted in different ways, but he actually said this. He said that early on in this dig area, they'd opened it up to secular evolutionists to look at it, and they had not realized that it was in a graded bed with big bones at the bottom and little bones at the top. And he said it actually took a flood geologist to look at it and say, well, actually, these are graded. And because water would do this, because they had said it was some kind of a braided stream bed over hundreds of thousands of years, these animals would fall in and somehow get disarticulated and end up. But it just, it doesn't match what you're seeing. Right. So that was a big deal.
Right, it was his paradigm. And coming from that paradigm, it helped him say, hey, make sense of what of the data before them.
And he was interested in the GPS stuff. I know you were really interested in this.
Well, you know, that was fascinating to me because it's something I hope is not lost on our viewers. Because Art Chadwick, in his work there, and the way that they use this sophisticated GPS equipment, whenever they begin to uncover a bone, and they take these GPS readings and positions as small as a few inches apart, and then they use that to record the location of that bone, the orientation of that bone, where it is in that meter strata. And then all of that is brought back into a software system where you can actually see it in a 3D form, rotate it around and so forth. Well, it's one of the best in the world. And he's considered, you know, at the top of the world in terms of how they do that.
No, he gives presentations about this because he, I mean, he's been building this for years. You can go online and see it. You can look at a bone and see it, turn it. And we actually saw them taking pictures of it down there. Yep. So
people, the accusation oftentimes that the creation scientists are unscientific, they're unprofessional. I mean, you look at Art Chadwick and say, man, he's people seek him out in what he's done. I think it was National Geographic, I think.
That's right. They worked his Anantosaurus bones that he had found. And I think that that's an important thing about Art, is Art was very quick to say, I don't understand these things. There's a lot of things I don't understand, and he would bring up a lot of the things that he still didn't understand. But his comment was his creation actually made the most sense with what he saw and knew, and that was what came into this. You know, I don't understand how an evolution can see this, because I don't even see this in the data. They say we have blind faith, but that seems a lot like blind faith. It's this role that faith is not something that is based out here, but as I think as Augustine said, it's faith seeking understanding. You have a reason, we have a world around us that we can understand. Some things we may understand better than others, but faith is very much not irrational, that rather it works together with our understanding of the world with the recognition we are fallen and the way that we see things. So Art was very good there, and I think that he then actually, when we were talking to them, he actually brought up soft tissue. And he himself said, so Art has an interesting background as a molecular biologist. Originally, in his excellent article on the trilobites, looking at the molecular biology at the very lowest layers, what would these animals have been like molecularly? And they would have been radically complex. So he then talked about walking around and sometimes finding bones break open. Because, you know, sometimes they would have bones, they would get broken. And he said many times you would look inside and see strange looking material that as a molecular biologist did not look like fossilized material. And that led us then to talking about really a very interesting area, soft tissue and dinosaur bones.